Gather together in one accord. Those who join us in the live stream, we're thankful for you also. It's actually wonderful to have a fellowship with such depth. Amen. And breadth. Yeah. Amen. A lot of people don't have this, you know. They know of kindred spirits that separate them by great distances, but they have no way of actually simultaneously being with each other. Yeah. Consciously being with each other. And tonight we're going to be in the third chapter of John, verses 31 through 33. This will be our 39th exposition. Now, you may have noticed this already, particularly if you do any amount of reading or have been accustomed to doing reading, that in the writings of men, particularly when they deal with problematic areas, there's an awful lot of supposition and theorizing, conjecture, hypothesizing. They don't seem to have any really sure answers. Now, it's pretty consistent. Writings of men, a pointed, detailed analysis is very rare. Some people try and develop it, but it's always very, very surface, particularly if you're a Bible reader. You're accustomed to a different kind of expression. What they do write on is, I call it peppered with words like if, and could be, and possibly, and words like that. That there's not a surety that characterizes their writing. You get the idea. There's kind of stabbing in the dark. Whereas my grandfather used to say, like a blind hog rooting for an acorn. They know there's something to be found, but they haven't found it. That points to the fact that human knowledge is fragmentary. That's why people of the world, this isn't their preference, the preferred way to write. That's just what you're, that's how you have to write. If you're talking about the things of the world, that's just how you have to write. Because man's knowledge is fragmentary. And there's a lot of critical factors that they avoid altogether. But the scriptures, they speak quite differently. Yeah. You don't get the idea of a guesswork, you know, whether you're reading Moses or the prophets or Jesus or the apostles, it's not like that. See, there's a kind of a tone of certainty in everything that's said. If the Bible says there is, I mean, that's different than saying there is a possibility. There's a whole lot of difference. If your mind is cultured spiritually, you have a spiritually cultured mind. That is, your mind is used to trafficking in truth. You're used to doing that. You read words like "he that," you know, it's just the blanket statement, or "all they," yeah, see? Right. Or "everyone," amen. Or "all that." Mm-hmm. Then you read about a condition. This is, if they assess the past, this was, you know, it's just. In the future, this will be. See, there's an element of certainty in everything that's said. And actually, the human spirit needs this. To survive, you've got to have something to hold on to that's sure, see. The Word of God doesn't only speak of circumstances that exist, it tells you why they exist. And it tells you how they're to be addressed. If it's something you should spend time on, or if you should not. See, it's a different kind of writing. Motivational preachers and teachers, at least in the last few decades, have been prone to talk about, quote, possibility thinking. It's a psychological term, but it's been picked up by certain classes of ministers. Possibility thinking, see? See how vague it leaves you with a vague. You're like you're on water, trying to tread wavy, stormy water. If the possibility, if think about what's possible, think what's possible, and then think about it, and maybe it'll turn out. See, well, actually, there are some people that are trying to reach heaven that way. They don't know that there's solid things to build on. Well, they rely on self-strength and their own ingenuity and so forth to make it through life. Now, the scripture, we're going to see an example tonight. It'll tell you whether who's talking and where they're from, because that'll bear on the value of their words, where they're from. They won't talk about cities and countries. They'll talk about heaven or earth. You know, tell you where the thing is from and how that bears on what they say. Yes.
To get into heaven and following Christ, there can't be a possibility mindset.
That's right.
A possibility that you're right means there's a possibility that you're wrong.
That's right.
And as long as that possibility exists, someone's not going to give their all for Christ.
I don't know of any intelligent preacher that would tell people this may not happen. You know, they don't say that, but they preach that way. They might say that was in the age of miracles. See, they might say something like that. Or God doesn't do that anymore. Now that don't do that anymore. See, so they modify things, but that's not the way the scriptures don't talk about that. The scriptures don't say, now when this age is ended, you'll have to just kind of navigate on your own after that. Until the apostles die, you'll have to kind of...
As soon as you discount God's ability to do whatever he wants,
that's right.
You have to speak in possibilities.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's why I personally never argue about the possibility of miracles. Because as long as there's a God, there can be a miracle.
Amen. That's right.
Amen.
I know that you can't map it out, but you can't take that from people these chief qualities of God.
Amen.
He's able to make
Amen.
You stand. See, you can't
Amen.
Take that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's with the temptation, there's a way of escape. See, you can't take that
Amen.
From people and leave them on their own.
Amen.
Actually, people don't teach things like that to put people on shifting sin. They're reacting to some kind of false emphasis.
Yeah.
And so they swing way over to the opposite side. Some people say, well, that always happens. No, that never happens, see. But when you read the Word of God, things aren't affirmed that way. So we'll see an example of that tonight. John 3, 31 through 33. John the Baptist is talking. He's answering these men. His disciples have come and said, hey, there's another man baptizing, and all the people are going to him. Well, what about this? Opportune time now for John to start a John the Baptist church. See, there's some today. There's some churches today that are John the Baptist churches. There are. That's a name. He that cometh from above is above all. Now, he doesn't say, be careful what I say, because these people may not be educated. He just comes right out and says this.
Yeah.
He that cometh from above is above all. Notice the certainty. He that is of the earth is earthly. And speaking of the earth, he that cometh from above is above all. And what he has seen and heard, that he testifieth, and no man receiveth his testimony. He that hath received his testimony has set to his seal that God is true. See how... Just like a solid hammer nailing the thing down, see? There's no ambiguity, uncertainty at all.
Amen.
And that's characteristic of Scripture.
Yeah.
Now, it might surprise you that inadvertently some people can read the Bible like it's suggestions or something like that. But you want to keep these things in your mind, and we stir one another up to keep this in your mind. Yeah, but what if, or this could mean, or I think what people are trying to do, or you've got to purge this from your thinking as much as you can. And when you're dealing with the things of God, put God at the center, and speak like the scriptures speak. Now, John is establishing the superiority of Christ because his disciples have suggested there's some kind of competition. They didn't know. They weren't saying there was, but that's what they kind of suspected, that this could be competing with John. Because now John had been taking the countryside by storm, and all of a sudden, here's this other teacher. So he's establishing the superiority of Christ and what he says. Because multitudes were coming out to hear him, not to see him, to hear him.
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
They come out, multitudes come out to hear him.
Yeah.
Oh. And they brought their sick to be healed, I understood, but that was second, not first. He that cometh from above. Now, no other human being came.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No person born of man came into the world.
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. See? From someplace else. Mm-hmm. Nobody. Only Jesus. Several times Jesus would say, I came. He'd say that. I came. Not I came from Jerusalem, but I came into the world. I came. Now, ponder the gravity of these statements. Jesus came into the world. Now, why wouldn't you listen to somebody like that?
Yeah, amen.
Came into the world. Here's something he said. I came out from God. Whew, how's that? I came out from God. I came forth from the Father, John 16:28. In his prayer in Gethsemane, he said, I came out from thee, which means God sent him.
Yeah.
So he just didn't come from there to here. He was sent from there to here.
Yeah.
This means that Jesus coming into the world was a result of a divine initiative.
Yeah. Amen.
This is something God caused. Nobody on earth said, send us a man from heaven. Nobody said that. Job wished there was a go-between, but nobody asked for somebody for heaven to send somebody from there to here. I doubt that they might have thought an angel maybe could be sent from there to here, but not a man. So this means that there was a purpose that drove this, because God never does anything he doesn't purpose. See, you do a lot of things inadvertently. You didn't plan to do it. You just did it. But it's not the way God is. Because
mm-hmm.
He sees all things, knows all things. You understand? So the purpose belonged exclusively to God. So you can't look at Christ with your agenda in mind. It won't work. You'll be disappointed.
Yes.
You'll be disappointed if you think that Jesus came to earth to satisfy you, you'll be disappointed. It won't work out. You'll not live one day without questioning whether that is true or not. But now if God said, and that's another situation. So the time that Jesus came, that was set by God. The time he came. And the reason for him coming, why that was set by God. And the time of his entrance was set by God, and the time of his exit was set by God. What he was to do when he was here was set by God. See, everything was ordered strictly. Now, strictly, it was strictly ordered by God. Jesus grew for 30 years. He grew, advanced, to kind of bring his humanity up to speed, so to speak, because when he entered into the world, he didn't like automatically know everything.
Yeah,
see, that wasn't the way it was.
Uh-huh.
He had to be taught.
Yeah.
How about that?
Mm-hmm.
He grew in wisdom.
Yeah.
But he didn't commence his ministry till he brought his humanity up to speed.
Yeah,
that's the way it should be with you.
Yeah, amen.
You should not endeavor to do something for God until you're humanity is brought up to speed, so to speak, sanctified. So nothing about the reason why Jesus was sent or what he was due when he was sent, none of that was set by men. Men didn't establish any of that, none at all. Or for that purpose, or John the Baptist either. It was, certainly was not to make men comfortable in his present evil world. If someone came from heaven to earth, it couldn't have been to establish earth. If that's what God wanted, he had just made it that way in the beginning. Of course, it's one thing to have an intellectual awareness of these things I've just said. That's one thing. But it's another thing to build your life on it. Now, that's something else. That's where the challenge comes in, to live in view of these realities. That's what's living by faith. God tells you the true circumstance, how everything was established by him. He sent the Son. He established what the Son was to do, and then the Son was not going to come back until he did it. See? Now you know how to use this in living. You've got to translate all that into practicality, into how you live. So if you live worried about everything, fretting about everything, see, you've got to go back and review this.
That's right.
You have to go back and review it. This is not, you're scared of everything. You got to go back and review this. Amen. This is God's world. It's not yours.
Amen.
Satan's the god of it, but he's governed by God.
That's right.
Yep. The devil couldn't make a flood happen.
Yeah.
He would have if he could have.
Yeah.
But he couldn't. Satan has succeeded in tempting unstable men to create methods and procedures that will teach people how to live. You go down to the Bible bookstore now and look at the shelf. See, and if you want to, take a little scratch pad, make a note of how many books are how-to books and what-to-do books and how to have a successful marriage and how to, just see how many there are. So here's men, trying to address the problems that are inherent to humanity living in this world, and they're going to tell them how to handle all this stuff. It may sound really wise, but it's not. The fact that it came down from above means that's where the resources are. Where did somebody come from? Where from the warehouse. They had to come from the warehouse, so to speak. Now he says, he that cometh from above, he himself is above all. So there's no one that's not subject to him. He's above all. That's a strong reason for listening to him now. That's a very strong reason for following him and becoming one of his disciples. He is above all. Even when he walked among men, he was above all.
Amen.
He was superior to men, superior to them. He had authority they didn't have. He could do things they couldn't do. Because God loved the Son and gave all things into his hand. That's what Jesus said. He had him in his hand when he was here. He had him in his hand. He didn't go back to heaven to get everything. He had it when he was here. He could command winds, waves, illnesses, fevers, leprosies. He could tell fish what net to jump in, bring up a coin, find one down there in the floor of the ocean and bring it up. He was over all when he was here.
Amen.
Now it's even more pervasive, even now. Jesus of Nazareth never met a person he didn't not have the right to command. Or a demon either.
Yeah, that's right.
He was over all.
Amen. There's a sense which is...
There was a sense of frustration in this for Jesus too. Now remember, he created everything.
Yeah.
And this compared to that may seem simple, and yet he put himself in a condition of limitation.
Yeah.
He couldn't be everywhere at the same time.
That's right.
That's why he said it's good for you for me to go away. Because now, like you said, now it's even more pervasive. He can be everywhere and minister at all times.
Mm-hmm. Now, as you know, Jesus came ultimately to equip the people he redeemed to create, to bring them to heaven to rule up there. Mm-hmm. All right, that means they're going to have to really know how to think.
Yes.
Huh? They're going to have to know what to do. Hence, the earth as an environment.
Yeah.
Hence, the devil as an opponent, see? Hence, the flesh that is weak.
Yeah, amen.
Hence, time
that
passes you by. So if you see this as God has set up these circumstances so the one who is from above can teach you how to handle, how to handle these shifting circumstances, because where you're going, that's what you're going to be doing.
Yeah.
You're going to be raining.
Yes.
The details of it aren't provided.
Mm-hmm.
But we're going to be raining over something. So I say, the epistles say that Jesus has been exalted far above all principality and dominion and every name is named, not only in this world, but in the world to come. See, and there's other dominant personalities in the other world that never lived on earth. They're dominant. And we're going to be joint heirs with Christ, who reigns over all these.
Wow.
Oh, my. Don't set some kind of petty little promise out to me when I've got something like that.
Yeah,
you can be, come on, don't even talk to me. When you see that he that's above all, I'm in him, and he's working with me to be a joint heir, co-heir. Well, it's quite large to say the least.
Yes.
And he says, now he that's of the earth, now this is true of all men that are of the earth, but John is particularly referring to himself. He's comparing himself with Jesus. He's not comparing Herod with Jesus or Pilate with Jesus or Gamaliel with Jesus. He's comparing himself with Jesus. He's from above. I'm earthly. Not earthly by sinful earthly. Earthly by this is where I'm of the lineage of Adam. That kind of earthly. Remember when Jesus was talking to Nicodemus about the new birth, he says, if I've told you of earthly, but those are things that happen in earth that aren't going to happen in heaven. See, nobody's going to be born again in heaven. That's an earthly thing. And while that seems like this is the most important thing of all, to get people born again, that is not true. No matter how loud they shout this, that is not true. The purpose is to get him ready to reign there. That's the purpose.
That's right.
And to do that, you have to be born again because of that.
Amen.
Not just to be better here.
That's right.
Amen.
Because I think we've mentioned this before, some other world religions can make you better here.
Yeah.
Self-discipline and thoughtful and things like this. He that is of the earth, he that is of the earth is earthly. That is, he has more connections with earth than he does at this time with God. This is a denigrating because there wasn't any man up to that time that John wasn't greater than, like if you want to compare with peers and this sort of thing, he was greater than others, but he couldn't be a savior.
That's right.
He couldn't be a deliverer. He couldn't be a mediator or an intercessor, see? He was of the earth, earthly. But he that cometh from heaven, he's above all. In other words, this implies that he brought something from heaven with him.
Yes, amen.
When he came. Several times I list him here that he said he came from heaven. This time John says Jesus came from heaven, implying he brought words and benefits down. Here's God's assessment of the situation. He brought that from heaven, see? That was heaven's assessment.
Yeah.
Jesus didn't look at the world as a man and say, no, this is what the problem is. He brought the assessments down from heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus spoke of inheriting the earth. See, nobody else. There's been world leaders that dreamed of inheriting the earth, but he talked about an individual inheriting the earth.
Yeah.
And he spoke about the world to come, John the Baptist, and never spoke about the world to come. He is full of the Holy Spirit, but he didn't talk to the people about the world to come. You might imply it by he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather wheat into the barn, but that's an implication, but he never clearly talked about the world to come. He talked about things that happened right here, because these things that he talked about had to happen here before Jesus could exercise his ministry. There's a point at which you've got to arrive before anything between you and God can get underway. You have to be born again. You have to be translated into the kingdom. See, this has to happen before anything can get underway. And Jesus came down to tell us this.
Yes.
And I actually outlined how it was done. What Jesus talked about, he talked about a spiritual resurrection and a bodily resurrection. And John the Baptist didn't talk about either one, right?
Yeah.
He didn't talk about either one of them. He talked about earthly things. He talked about when he was going to come in all of his glory. John the Baptist didn't talk about that. He said he was going to confess men before the angels. John the Baptist didn't talk about that. I'm not denigrating John the Baptist. I'm showing you that John the Baptist ministry wasn't the conclusion. It was the beginning. He declared that God would give his Holy Spirit to men. John the Baptist didn't say that. He said Jesus baptized men with the Holy Spirit, but the people didn't know what that meant, and they still don't know very much about what it means. He talked about earthly things. He did not refer to the existence of Jesus before he came to earth. He made no reference to that. Jesus did. Or what he would do after he died. He made no reference to that. He made no reference to Jesus suffering for sin. He said he took away the sin of the world, but he didn't comment on suffering for sin. He didn't comment on him rising from the dead, right? Or ascending into heaven. This didn't mean he omitted any of these things in his message. It just means that wasn't the message he was given to declare. Yes, brother.
Yeah, I was just musing a little bit on the difference between Christ having authority when he was on the earth during his days of his flesh versus the authority that he has now after his incarnation. You see, Christ coming to the earth, he couldn't save us just by like pure authority.
That's good.
He had to lay down his life and take it up again. And then once he went back to heaven, this is the first time a man has entered into heaven and been received. So, and then his reign in heaven now is salvific. He's there to bring many sons to glory.
That's right.
He's not just there to be like an authority figure.
Yeah.
He is an authority figure.
Yeah.
He does have all authority, but he's been exalted there as a priest. He's there to be our Savior. That's why in the book of Revelation, when John saw him, he was a lamb as he had been slain.
That's right.
That's how he's represented in heaven in his glory. So so that, yes, he had authority upon the earth, but until he had actually laid down his life and taken it up again, see, the day of salvation couldn't commence until he then went as the risen Savior, then we had to go back into heaven.
Amen. Yep. Yeah, a man had to bring us to heaven.
That's right.
Yeah. A man had to effectively intercede for us. A glorified man. Yeah. That's a technicality that God knew, but that was a bit hazy. Even to the prophets, that was a bit hazy. It took some of the apostolic proclamation to drive this point home, that Jesus is glorified, all of heaven worships and praises him, but he's a glorified man. And when all of this is over, he himself is going to be subject to the Father. How's that? He that cometh from heaven, that's all wrapped up in he that came from heaven. And what he has seen and heard, that he testifieth. Remember, this is what John the Baptist is saying about Christ. As men spend a lot of time in speculative thinking and philosophical speaking, but Jesus never indulged in that kind of thing. He never did this. You never get the idea that Jesus was unsure of himself when he talked, but any person who's spoken publicly has felt this lack of certainty. They try and stay off subjects they don't know very much about. They try and stay off, but there wasn't any subject Jesus didn't know everything about. See, wasn't at all. The God of heaven even said this. He asked, why did the heathen rage and the people imagine vain things? See, that's a category of things that men spend an enormous amount of time on, these vain things. Some other versions call them futile things or useless things or folly. In other words, vain things, they lead nowhere. They end at a dead end. They may look very promising at the beginning, but they can't deliver any satisfactory results. So it doesn't make sense. See, they can't be productive. So it doesn't make sense to give yourself to thinking about something that's going to end up in the trash heap. It doesn't make any sense to have that kind of thing dominate your thinking. And it can. You could be like thinking about a job or your home or your children in a dominating sort of a way. See, it's not in a way, Lord, give me grace to do this. It's to some people, they fret. They fret and they worry, and what if this happens, and what if that happens? And see, it's all vain, vain things. The Lord Jesus didn't spend a single second with vain things. He was never diverted. Everybody here will have to admit that they have experienced a diversion in their thinking. Sometimes you wake up, I recently have had a circumstance that I've been unable to control. It's not personal, but a circumstance unable to control. I was trying to find how to correct this, and finally the Holy Ghost got through to me. He said, why don't you bring this matter? Now, I know you probably never experienced that, but that I did. This is just like recent. He said, yes. Plead your cause. Produce your cause. See? I'm showing that being heavenly minded, spiritually minded, this requires considerable effort, and sometimes you forget something you don't think you'd ever forget it. But here comes a circumstance, a challenge, you didn't, and oh, Bill, you spend days, and finally you wake up and say, whoa, forgive me, Lord. I've been approaching this like we didn't have a man in heaven. Vain things. So Jesus didn't address it. So this is why, if you're looking for certain kind of social problems or domestic problems, you're looking for something Jesus said about it, it's hard to find it. That's why it's hard to find it. This isn't what he talked about. But if you pay attention to what he talked about, you will be able to address these other things. Now he says, you know, what he has seen, that's what he talks about what he's seen. Now, see, that would make obsolete a lot of people's speaking careers. If the only thing they could talk about is what they'd seen or comprehended. He said, "When I saw Satan as lightning fall from heaven." Yeah, nobody else saw that.
That's right.
He saw it. He saw it. He said this, "I speak that which I have seen with my Father." See? That's when he was in heaven. He's telling us things he saw when he's with God. He confessed he had seen the Father. I've seen the Father. Nobody else could say that. He'd seen the Father, and that's what he spoke about. Well, I can tell you, when you see God, you perceive God, that is about what you start talking about. When you truly see God, you truly see Christ, your subject is so dominant.
Yes.
That pretty soon you're thinking about this and talking about this all the time.
Amen.
You can't make people do this now, understand? I've tried, you know. You can't make people do this. You got to give them something to see, enable them to see. He said, I speak that which I have seen with my Father. John 8:38. He confessed, I've seen the Father. John 6:46. He declared, the Father loveth the Son because he showeth him all things that he himself doeth. Jesus has seen the plan.
Amen.
He seen the blueprint. That's what he talked about. Remember when God shows you something, don't you find that's what you what you talk about, what you've been shown. He says, the Father loves the Son, showeth him all things that he himself doeth, and he will show him greater than these, that you may marvel. See, so how's that?
Yeah.
Sometimes I do. I just have to stand back and marvel at what Jesus says. Just penetrates into your heart. And why would anyone spend an inordinate amount of time exposing their mind to inferior wisdom? Why do people do this? Now, if you're in the education world, you're required to do this. But if you walk with the Lord for a while, you find yourself, I'm not able to do this. Because if you expose your mind willingly to inferior things long enough, some of those things become part of your thinking process. That's the way you're wired.
Amen.
God made you this way, so whoever you spend more time with impacts the way you think.
Amen.
See, man can't really experiment without some effects taking place. You know, we're taught, Jesus, he says, ye have not so learned Christ, if so be that ye have heard him and have been taught by him. See, so why would I choose a secondary teacher if I have access to God? Now, I understand that God has set teachers in the church. I understand this. And there's some like academic things that pertain to this world someone has to tell you. But I understand it. We're not talking about that kind of thing. We're talking about culturing your mind and culturing your spirit. How do you do it? Best to major on taking what Jesus said.
You know, I can remember going to public school as a young person, and at that time there wasn't a lot of homeschooling even being done that I recall anyway. But my mother did what best she could. She sent me to school, so I learned. But I can still remember some of the things that they taught me that I knew weren't right. But they insisted that I say it that way, that I write it down on the test.
Yeah.
And even as a young person, I thought, I know it's not true.
Yeah.
But see, you're right. This is, they expect you to saturate your mind with these things. And so it's a very, very, when you get to where you can choose the right thing.
That's right. Mm-hmm. See, until you can choose, you're under tutors and governors.
Right.
But it's important that they be the right tutors and governors. So what the Lord makes known as absolute truth is unvarying and therefore liberating. See? That's why truth, you know the truth will make you free, is because it's unvarying. It's solid, unchanging. So he speaks what he's seen and what he's heard. Verily I say unto you, we speak that we do know. This is Jesus talking to Nicodemus. We speak that we do know and testify that what we have seen. He said of his verbal communication, I know that his commandment is life everlasting. Whatsoever I speak, therefore, even as the Father said unto me, heard. See, even as the Father said unto me, so I speak. So he not only knew what God said, he knew why he said it. He knew what the Father was doing. Now we, before the day dawns tomorrow, you will confront multiple things that you will not know why they happened or what the outcome of them is going to be. You're going to have a lot of this stuff will happen before you wake up tomorrow morning. Jesus, he wasn't that way. See? He knew what was, he saw what was to be seen, he heard what was to be heard, and he knew why all of this happened. He didn't withhold anything from his disciples. Whatever he seen and heard, it wasn't just private. He said, "Verily I say unto you, I speak therefore as the Father said unto me, so I speak." Then he says to his disciples, "Henceforth, from now on, I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you."
Amen.
See? He accented what God was doing, see? Everything the Father told me, made known to me, I told you. Why? Because that's why God made it known to him as a man.
Yeah, yeah.
As growing up in the world, he made it known to him. He knew all this stuff before he left heaven. He knew all this.
Yeah.
He didn't have to be taught while he was there.
Yeah.
When he took upon himself the form of a man, now he had to be taught. And he knew that if God teaches you something, it's not intended just to be for you.
Yeah. Amen.
Pass it on.
Yeah.
I can't tell you how much I've profited from people who have had communion with God that have told me about what they've learned.
Yeah.
Well, I couldn't even begin to estimate how much that benefited me.
Mm-hmm.
Because maybe what you see, it's intended to be communicated.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone doesn't have to learn like firsthand only. This is why human religious agendas are wrong. This is why they're wrong. When men make an agenda that determines what they do and how they do it and when they do it and where they do it, this is why this is wrong. Because there already exists a kingdom agenda.
Yeah, amen.
Already exists.
Yeah.
Particularly when it comes to men and God, the church and Christ, there's already an agenda in place. It's been communicated to us what it is and what's to go on in this agenda. And there's some agendas that are competing with God's agenda.
Mm-hmm.
So much so, this is just one example. So much so that some people on the Lord's day would abandon God's agenda so they could serve the community.
Mm-hmm.
And some people say, that's wonderful. That is just wonderful. No, that is not wonderful. You can do that Monday through Saturday.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And no, it's not. It's never right to abandon God's agenda to adopt some man's agenda.
Yeah.
This is never right.
Amen.
If a person has a problem with sin and transgression and immorality and this sort of thing, God's told us what to do about it.
Mm-hmm.
Confess that.
Yeah.
I'll forgive it, and then I'll cleanse you from all unrighteousness.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's wrong to avoid that counsel for human counsel.
That's right.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
And the human counsel is circular. You just have to keep on. But in Christ, he'll cleanse you. He'll forgive Saul of Tarsus from persecuting the church, and he'll not have any more further problem with that.
Yeah.
Cleansed from all unrighteousness. The messengers of Christ, and they were unwavering in their consistency. They were sent out to declare in no uncertain terms what God was doing. John the Baptist preparing a people for the Lord Jesus. See, that they were told what his purpose was. It was spelled out. So that when Jesus comes, folk will be ready for him. Ready to receive him. They won't be looking for a governor or a king, earthly king, or an athlete.
Mm-hmm.
they'll know what he's coming for.
Right.
They'll be ready for it. People who are serving God make known what pleases God. God has announced what pleases him. Mm-hmm. Jesus pleased him. God saw the travail of his soul and he was satisfied. Jesus was well pleasing. God said, "This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased." And if God's well pleased with him, I mean, why shouldn't we be? You know? How is it that men are not pleased with him if God is? That's how you reason. The reason for Christ's death. See, after Jesus went back to heaven, he unveiled why he died. People didn't know. But it was unveiled. Then, I know the prophets gave you a pretty good idea about it. The iniquities of the world were laid upon him and so forth, travail of his soul. But it was still kind of hazy. But God knew that if people don't know why Jesus died, they'll forget about it. They'll find something else to do rather than remember him. Mm-hmm. His blood won't mean that much to them if they don't know what it did and what it's still doing. They clarified the day of judgment. See, they cleared that up, the day of judgment. You're just not going to die, and that's it. After you die, you're going to stand at the judgment. And you make got to make sure you're walking with the one that's going to represent. You got to be on good terms with the mediator on that day. See, they made all of this known. This wasn't that clear. Gamaliel didn't see this. He didn't see beyond what was going on in the world. But Jesus, then he illuminated his apostles, so they enlightened as a look. Today is not the only day. And when days run out, you're still going to be. You want to be ready for when there isn't any more earth, heavens and earth. And God's preparing you for that time and for death, which is inevitable. They clarify the destiny of the faithful and the destiny of the unfaithful. See, people aren't being told this today. People are so caught up in problem resolution, they're not telling people the outcome of living by faith or not living by faith. See, it's spelled out. It's heaven or lake of fire. But this isn't, it's not being spelled out. If we were to remove yourself from apostolic doctrine and the things God has done, everything would become mysterious. The Bible wouldn't be clear. If you were just to remove that understanding, what God did in Christ, why he did it, what the outcome was going to be, you took that, extracted that from your reasoning. You did not know those things. You'd probably do what Solomon did. And so in Solomon, you see what people will do. The wisest people, the smartest people, the most gifted people, what they will do if they don't have a wide scope of understanding about God. And God showed it in Solomon. It wasn't what Solomon was especially, particularly evil, although God was upset with him. It's that this is what happens when you don't have a grasp on what God is doing. All right, he says, now he speaks, speaking of Jesus, he speaks what he's seen and heard, and then he says that no man receives his testimony. He didn't say a few men receive his testimony. He said no man. No man receives his testimony. Other versions read, no one received his testimony, no one accepts his testimony, no one takes his witnesses true. His testimony is not accepted by anybody. How few people believe that what he tells them. That's kind of weak there. That's the New Living Translation. No one accepts his proof, yet no one accepts his testimony. No one receives his evidence as true. That's quite a statement. That tells you why someone concocts a recovery plan when God's already got one. Why did they do that? They did not receive Christ's testimony. That's why. Why is it people think they can dabble in sin? They haven't received Christ's testimony. He said, he that sinneth becomes a servant of sin. See? No man receives his testimony. Jesus, well, it's quite remarkable. Now, this appears to contradict what John's disciples said. They said, all men come to him. See, that sounds like it contradicts everyone rejects his testimony. It didn't say all men believed on him. That's not what it... They came to him. Doesn't say they believed on him. Seeing, being exposed to Jesus and believing him, that's two different things. And eventually, it'll get right down to this. Until a man's born again, he will not be able to accept everything Jesus says.
Amen.
Gets right down to that. You got to have ears to hear.
Yeah, that's right.
No man receives his testimony. No one took him seriously. It appeared they did for a while. See, but they were turned away from him too easily. They wanted to hear what he had to say, but there's no sign it was eagerly received. Some did. The prophet Isaiah, he said, God speaking to him, said, when I called, was there none to answer? Why? He was asking a question. Why when I called, wasn't there someone to answer? That's God. I know, but you're not going to say to God, well, there's a lot of people that answer. This is God talking.
That's right.
Again, Isaiah said, who's believed our report? It wasn't that it was a bad report. See, that perfectly parallels what he's saying here. John wrote, he came to his own, and his own received him not. There it is. See, it's in the scripture. Jesus said to the Jews, now ye seek to kill me, a man that hath told you the truth. How about that? One of the great tragedies of our day is proportionately few people who are willing to listen to Jesus. Tremendous tragedy. Yes, Brother Jason.
Yeah, there always comes a point where something Jesus has to say offends.
That's right.
People, it contradicts their agenda or what they want to do. It's like later in John, when all those disciples, he said, you got to eat my flesh and drink my blood. And they said, oh, this is a hard saying.
It's a hard saying.
And it says from that point on, many disciples left, went away. See?
Yeah.
Well, what we have today is we have people there's a certain kind of Jesus that people do like.
Oh, yeah.
He's kind of the friendly, smiling, hippie Jesus who loves everybody, you know. But there are certain things Jesus say that people say, oh, I can't receive that. I can't receive that. And see, the thing about his testimony is you have to receive all of it.
That's right.
That's it.
You can't say, well, Jesus, I like you as far as it goes here.
Yeah.
Or, but I can't go any, well, you can't be my disciple then.
That's right.
Say. You can't follow me that far and then stop.
Amen. And that's the key to what he means here. That's exactly right. It isn't that every jot and tittle that he said was rejected. It was that his overall, he was, eventually, if you keep listening to Jesus, eventually either what he says will offend you or will unlock things for you.
Yes, amen.
It'll, either you'll fall on the stone, or the stone will fall on you. And that's what he's talking about here. He said something they couldn't receive, as Brother Jason pointed out. And that's what this text is talking about here. Isn't that some statement? You seek to kill me, a man that has told you the truth. That's John 8:40. Now it continues, he that hath received his testimony is set to a seal that God is true. Notice how this stayed out. He that receives his testimony is set to a seal that God is true. He didn't say, has set to a seal that what God said, that what Jesus said was true. That's not what it says. That God is true. This is God's assessment now of how people are to respond to the Son. Men may settle for a partial commitment, occasional response. God will not. He that hath received his testimony or received his witness or accepted it. What does it mean to receive Christ's testimony? To say, well, I don't find anything wrong with that. That's not what it means. It means to believe it and act upon what's said. His testimony is not received until it's acted upon favorably. And remember, he's telling you what he's seen and heard. That's what you're reacting to. Whatever subject he has addressed, that's how that subject is to be addressed. Whatever he said about it. So we'll take, since it's a favorite subject of today, marriage. Let's say just take marriage. Now John, Ephesians 5 is an extended. He's actually talking about Christ and the church, but he uses the husband and wife. So now that's not a goal to shoot for. That's what God has to say about marriage. And if marriage is not that way, Christ has offended the person. So I know all kinds of church people that violate what's in Ephesians 5. Husband not caring for their wives, wives not obeying their husbands, children not obeying their parents. People think nothing of this. No. This is what God has said. They haven't received his testimony. He's given a testimony. He's told what a church should be. Have fervent charity among yourselves. See? Edify one another. Comfort one another. Exhort one another. See, that's his assessment of what an assembly is to do. But some people can't receive that. It offends them. Now, I just listed a few things here that were subjects Jesus addressed, which means this is what he said about these subjects is how we're to think about them.
Amen.
He addressed being a disciple. He said what sin was. He that commits sin is a servant of sin. To what righteousness was. We must fulfill all righteousness. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Loving one another, by this shall all men know you're my disciples. You have love one for another. Hell, you'll be cast out into everlasting fire. The devil, liar from the beginning, and a murderer. The end of the world, harvest time. The day of judgment, accountable time. See, Jesus spoke on these things. Doing what he says. If you do what I say, it's like a man build his house on a rock. The winds and the rains came and stood. Man didn't do what I said. It's like a man builds his house on the sand. And when the rains that came, it fell. Great was the fall. He talked about rewards. Great is your reward in heaven. He talked about being ready. Whoever's not ready will not be received. Faithfulness. Faithful over a few things, be faithful over many. Eternal life, he spoke about that. This is eternal life. Know thee, the only true God, and Jesus. The world to come. He talked about things you will have if you're faithful in the world to come. He talked about his own words. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words, they'll never pass away. Talked about the cares of the world. They choke the word so that it's unfruitful. Talked about unfruitfulness. Whoever doesn't bear fruit, my Father takes them away. He talked about being chosen. You've not chosen me, I've chosen you. See, he's spoken on all these things. But church people fuss about all these things. They debate about these things. They argue about these things. No man receiveth his testimony. See, that's what he...
Amen.
Now, the words that will now follow apply only to those who receive his words. He that received his testimony hath, and then now this only applies to people that receive his testimony. That is, they will be the people who, like Peter, will say, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of life. Forevermore give us this bread. See, they'll talk that way. In referring Christ to Christ's testimony, John is emphasizing that Jesus bears witness to something that is of another order. It's a different kind of testimony. He's not given heaven's view of earthly matters. See? But some people refuse to hear anything that's not relevant. What they mean is, how does this apply to us now? But you've got to adapt to what Jesus says. See, not take what Jesus says and address what you think is the critical matters. There's really no such thing as a salvation that allows a person to ignore Jesus' words. There is no such thing as a salvation that allows that. You say, well, what do we do about people that, well, that's God's, we can't make a final decision on things like that. But God is going to make one. And whoever has ignored his son will be ignored by God. That's the way it's going to wash out. I thank God we don't have to make a decision in these areas. We don't know enough to do it. See, it's not enough for a person to say, I believe every word in the Bible. That's I believe every word in the Bible. I used to hear that all the time, and I'd ask people in the revival meetings, how many here believe every word in the Bible? Every word now, every word. Boy, hands all over the place. And I'd say, how many of you have read every word in the Bible? You know, about two people. So they believe something they'd never read. I mean, if you read the Bible, you wouldn't believe every word in it. Maybe if you read it. What about the person that receives what he says? He has set to his seal. Now, some other versions say he's certified. Or he sets his seal to this. Think of a seal as a notary public. You have a document, it has to be notarized before it's validated. So the notary takes his seal, the notary seal, sets his seal. This, I'm going to use this, this document. Now, I'm going to use this document. This document is an official document, and it spells out the way things are. Now, when you receive Christ, that's when you set your seal to, you say, this is what I'm going to use now. This is what I'm going to use now to critique my life and to govern my life. I'm going to use this. This is, I'm going to set my seal to it that this is, I see this now. I see this, that this, what Jesus said, is ultimate truth, and I do not want to be among those that don't receive his testimony. Set your seal to it. And what does the seal prove? It proves that you are convinced God is true. Now see, you would think that it would say, this proves that you believe what God, what Jesus said was truth. Well, that's true, but that's not, see, takes it further, takes it a step further. Because Jesus is God's representative. See, God's speaking to us through Jesus. And so you set to your seal, see, the God that Jesus talked about, and then he revealed, because he said, I only tell you now what my Father told me, and I tell you what I've seen with my Father. See, so what you've seen was really the way it is. God is true. Or we could also say God is faithful. That is implied in the word also. Here's how some versions read. God is true. Set to his seal. God is true. The NIV says God is truthful. The New American Bible says God is trustworthy. The Living Bible says God is the fountain of truth. International English says God is real. The Amplified Bible says God is definitely certified, acknowledged, declared once and for all, and is himself assured that it is divine truth that God cannot lie. But I said, that was a, wasn't a translation, that was an exposition, but it's a pretty good exposition. So if Jesus said he saw it, and Jesus said what he heard, then you say, well, I know God can't lie, so there's no chance that this isn't right. This isn't true. So if I'm living in contradiction of this, and the word comes out, be careful for nothing. That's what was said now. And here I am, I'm being full of care over something. See? I've got to take my seal out. I've got to set to the seal. No, what Jesus said is true. God is true. I have do not have a right to worry. That doesn't mean you're never going to worry. It means when you do, you got to stop it. And you can stop it.
Yes.
Just as surely as a lame man can walk.
Amen.
You can stop it. Just as surely as a deaf man can hear. And a blind man can see. And a bowed over woman can straighten up. Yeah. And a woman with an issue of blood can be stopped. See, just that surely. Yes, that surely. If that's all we could convince people of, it'd be worth saying it over and over and over. If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believes. Yes, you never outgrow a need to hear that. At least I haven't. I can tell you after now coming on 80 years, I can tell you, I still had to be told that. Because every once in a while, I don't know what happens, but I get stupid. And first thing you wake up and say, wait a minute. Wait, I've got access to God with confidence. What am I trying to do here? Now, there's some things you can resolve them by some kind of an action. There's simple things you can do something about it. But there's other things you can't really resolve it, but you like beat your head against a wall to finally say, wait a minute, God is true.
Amen.
He says, you got to stop that fretting. One man told me, the psalmist said, fret not thyself because of evildoers. This old hillbilly guitar player said to me, if you fret yourself, you know who gets fretted. God is true. So this certification is not theoretic. It's not taking an official but impractical position. See, like a church official position. It's not that. The person who receives the testimony of Jesus does something with that testimony. He takes it, he puts it in his bag. It's a new thing. When he sees it, it's a new thing. Put that in the bag. A wise scribe takes out of his bag things new and old. So when you get something new, put it in the bag. In other words, use it. Put it in the bag. The result, if you do that, the result is that when you may call it trials, challenges, whatever, but it's like rain, a rainstorm and a cyclone, your house won't fall.
Amen.
Now, Jesus has gone on record. Now, this is a commitment. Mm-hmm. He's gone on record. If you'll just do what I tell you to do, when these challenging times come that you can't do anything about them, I'll see to it that your house doesn't fall.
Yeah.
Boy, that's a piece of good.
Amen.
That's a piece of good news. He believes the record God has given of his son. Those who do not receive Christ's testimony, they don't conform their life to it. They choose to live some other way. Their life will end up futile. Their entire life has been a waste.
Yes, that's right.
Waste of time. That's how God will regard it. By their rejection of what Christ has said, they've aligned themselves against God. God says, I'm well pleased with my son. The person says, well, I'm not well pleased. I don't like what he said here. All right, now you become God's enemy. And guess who's going to win that skirmish? Jesus had it condemned already. So it's most unfortunate that an ignorance of Christ is so prevalent in our day among the professed church. But one thing each of us can do is resolve, beginning with me, I'm going to see to it this is not in me. That among the things I know, Christ is going to be one of them. I might know him, see, yes. And be found in him. That's going to be the main thing at the head of the agenda. Yeah. I'm going to make sure that I'm seeking the kingdom of God first. Uh-huh. And that anything that stands between me and that, I'm going to oppose it.
Amen.
Then you get a couple of people doing that, and boy, this transforms prayer. Let me tell you, this transforms prayer. Just two of you agree is touching something. It could be something like big.
Yes.
Doesn't take 1,000, 2,000, 100,000, just two.
That's right.
Two. What you're doing, you're putting your seals. You're setting your seal to it. That God's true.
Yes.
All things are possible with God. Jesus wants us to know that. Remember that man that came to Jesus? He said, if thou canst do anything, help us. Jesus said, if you can do anything, he just tossed the ball right back to him. If you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. So my word to you, brethren, is set your seal to this. To what Jesus has said. Set your seal to it. It'll make you impregnable. Mm-hmm. Doesn't mean you won't hurt. Doesn't mean that things from time to time will look like they're falling apart. But when the storm ceases, your house will still be there.
Yes.
Any of you want to add something before we go into prayer? Brother Jason?
You mentioned that thing about relevance. That's an important thing to comment on, because we hear that all the time, especially in the church. But it's a buzzword in the world, the culture too.
That's right.
Relevant. And of course, in the world, it changes every other day.
Mm-hmm.
In pop culture, what's relevant one week may not be relevant the next week.
Yeah.
And it's like trendiness. But the scriptures are always relevant.
Amen.
And what Jesus said is always relevant.
Amen.
Now, if we hear those things and we don't see the relevance, that may mean that like we're missing something.
Yeah.
We're out of sync.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so we may need to adjust to see why that word is relevant.
Yeah.
And there are people that don't understand why the scriptures are relevant. And one of the things the church is supposed to do is to show people why
that's good.
The word of God is relevant. It's always relevant. We don't have to worry about that.
That's
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes,
Lord said, heaven and earth will pass away. My word shall not pass
my
away.
Word, yes.
How could it be irrelevant?
That's right.
Anytime.
Yeah.
That's right.
They
otherwise, it pass away.
They just
That's
don't
right.
know.
Yeah.
What he said.
Amen.
Don't you find that you need to be stirred up here? Yes, Sister Hannah?
Earlier in your message, you had said that Jesus didn't come to earth to satisfy us. I was considering that Jesus came to earth to satisfy God.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
Yeah.
Very good. Jonathan?
When I think of a seal, I think of something that... It's something that's used to make something sure, like to acknowledge it as your own. And when we believe the scriptures, that we express that by sealing.
That's right.
And like by believing, it's not like a speculative type thing. I mean, when by believing, we are actually doing it under the conviction that this is actually from God.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the kings of old had a signet ring.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Joseph wore the king's ring.
That's right.
That stamp made it valid. All right. When you believe and receive what Christ said, that saying becomes yours.
Yeah,
yeah,
amen.
Right?
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Brother Gene.
It would be good for us to remember that God set his seal on Jesus.
That's
yes,
right.
Yeah.
Amen, God the Father.
This
That's
is
right.
my beloved Son,
yeah.
whom I'm well pleased.
Yeah.
Two times.
Right.
Yeah, Joseph did. Remember, he said, take my bones. He says, when you're visited by God, take my bones. Well, he was believing. He
That's
was
right.
Confessing. He's going to do what he said.
He didn't say, after I die, what difference does it make? What happens to my bones?
Right.
Yeah, that's what people say today. So.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Made a difference. Brother Judah.
Setting to your seal that God is true is for your recognition that God is true. It's
That's
not
right.
God may or may not be true, but since you put your seal on it, it's true. He's been true all along.
Mm-hmm.
You setting that to your seal, it's been said, you make it your own.
Amen.
So
That's
your
it.
Recognition of the truth
That's
that
it.
Enables you to set this to your seal.
Mm-hmm.
I used to hear as a young boy, we lived in Minnesota and snow sometimes is, 6 feet deep and 50 below zero, and so we couldn't travel, so we go down to Dad had come to a local Pentecostal church, and they knew the Bible pretty well, but I'd hear this language quite a bit. Make it your own. I didn't know what they meant by that. My father tried to explain it to me, but later I began to see, you make it your own. You can use it, in other
That's
words.
Right.
See? It's like the tool's got to fit your hand
Amen.
Before you use it.
Amen.
But when it does, you can use it.
Amen.
Mm.
Amen.
Anyone else tonight?
But again, I just want to thank you for sharing your testimony about that matter and about asking God. It's amazing how many scriptures there are that encourage us to come to God and ask, like, come and let us reason together.
Yeah.
Prayer can be like that.
Yeah.
You come and then in the midst of your prayer, God will reason with you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sometimes the resolution of the thing is not the immediate need. Sometimes the immediate need is to see the thing from a different angle.
That's right. That's
and
right.
As you come in prayer, God can kind of help you to see this thing from a heavenly viewpoint, from the throne room,
mm-hmm.
where it always looks a lot better.
Amen.
Yeah.
And so I needed to hear that tonight.
Yeah, your own experience will surprise you sometimes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It catch you unawares. You don't know how strong you are, and you don't know how weak you are either.
Uh-huh.
See?
Away from you when you're walking by faith, you are trusting in a source that is beyond your capability.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
That's right.
And so, and that's what asking is about. You're
that's
asking
right.
because you don't have the capability.
Yeah, that's right.
But that's what walking by faith is. You are trusting in His ability.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Up the mountain.
Yeah.
All right. Get ready for a prayer time.
Mm-hmm.